wonderful opportunity for doing dawah.
Yes, it is. But
what?
When I posed to him an article of faith, that is, belief in the hereafter, he completely disagreed with me. He thinks that a person with a logical and scientific argument cannot lend any credence to the belief in hereafter. He assumes that the one who does so does on the basis of blind belief. I don't know how to help him, brother.
Don't worry, brother. With the help of Allah, we shall get it cleared.
So first, can you tell me about the hereafter from the Quran?
Yes, of course. You see, there are more than 1,000 verses in the Quran that contain scientific facts. But many of these verses have been discovered by science in the last few centuries. But science has not advanced to a level where it can confirm every one of these statements. Suppose 80% of all that is mentioned in the Quran has been proved to be 100% correct. And the remaining 20, science does not make any categorical statement since it has not advanced to a level where it can either prove or disprove any of these statements. So, with the limited knowledge that we have, we cannot say for sure that even a single person or even a single verse is wrong of this 20%. Thus, when 80% of that is mentioned in the Quran is 100% correct and the remaining 20, it is not disproved. My logic says that even the 20% is correct. And believing in the hereafter, it comes in this 20% of the ambiguous statement, which my logic says is correct.
Subhanallah, the Quran indeed is an infallible book.
Yes, indeed. And I'm sure, Brother Ali, that you will agree with me that the concept of peace and human values is useless without believing in the hereafter.
Yes, indeed. But can you explain this to me with an example?
Yes, of course. Suppose I am the most powerful and the most influential criminal.
You, a criminal?
Just supposedly. And at the same time, I'm very logical and intelligent. I say that robbing is good for me because it helps me enjoy life. Thus, robbing is good for me.
But I can argue with the fact that the one who is robbed may face difficulties.
But it is good for me. If I rob $1,000, I can enjoy a meal at a 5-star restaurant.
But what if the police arrest you?
The police cannot arrest me. I have the police on my payroll. I have the ministers on my payroll.
But you have to agree that robbing is a selfish act.
I agree with you, brother, that robbing is a selfish act. But then why should I not be selfish? It helps me enjoy life. Hence, all arguments that you put forth that robbing is evil are futile. These arguments can be defended on the strength of reasoning and logic. Similarly, raping, cheating, etc. can all be justified to be good on the strength of reasoning and logic. It is no surprise that there are so many criminals in the world.
But then how can we prove to the criminals that these acts are evil?
A Muslim can convince the criminal that these acts are evil by giving an answer that is based on the belief of hereafter. As a Muslim, I shall convince the criminal about the existence of Almighty God. After I present to him the scientific facts, he, being a logical and scientific person, shall agree with me that God exists. And I shall also tell him that God Almighty is very powerful and he is the most just. As it is mentioned in Surah An-Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 40. O you who believe, Allah is never unjust in the least degree.
But then the question arises that why does not God punish the criminal?
Yes, the criminal also shall ask the same question. Any person who has suffered injustice, whether it be for social or financial status, most certainly wants the perpetrator of injustice to be punished. This life is a test for the hereafter. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2. Allazi khalaqal mawta wal hayata liabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala wa huwal azizul ghafur. It is He who created life and death, that He may try which of you is best indeed. And He is exalted in might and vice.
Yeah, I recall a similar verse from the glorious Quran. From Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 185. Every soul shall have a taste of death, and only on the day of judgment shall you be paid your full recompense. Only those who are saved far from the fire and admitted to the gardens shall have attained the object of life. For the life of this world is nothing but goods and chattels of deception. Final justice will be meted on the day of judgment. After a person dies, he will be resurrected with the rest of mankind. Allah may punish someone for this world, and the latter reward and punishment may be for the hereafter. Allah may not punish a robber or a rapist in this world, but he will surely be held accountable on the day of judgment.
Alhamdulillah, that is indeed a great reminder.
But then, what punishment would Hitler get?
Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, in Surah An-Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 56, those who reject our signs, we shall soon cast them out into the fire. As often as the skins are roasted through, we shall change them for fresh new skins, that they may taste the penalty of Allah. For Allah is exalted in might and vice. Now you see, if Allah wants, He can incinerate Hitler 6 million times in the hellfire. Now do you understand, Brother Ali, that the concept of human value and the good and evil nature of any act is impossible to prove without believing in the hereafter? I hope I have got it cleared for you.
Yes, brother, you've got it cleared. Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You called me last night, right?
Yes, I did.
What was the matter?
Brother, you know I'm a revert. And one of my non-Muslim friends, he asked me the question that the present Quran is not the original, but that of Usman radiallahu anhu. I wasn't in a position to answer him. So I thought that you could be the correct person because you have read the books on the four rightly guided caliphs.
Well, brother, sadly, some people have this misunderstanding. So let me get it clear for you. One of the most common myths about the Quran is that Usman radiallahu anhu, the third caliph of Islam, authenticated and compiled one Quran from a large set of mutually contradicting copies. The Quran, revered as the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the Muslims the world over, is the same Quran as the one revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It was authenticated and written under the personal supervision of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We will examine the roots of myth which says that Usman radiallahu anhu had the Quran authenticated. Whenever Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, received a revelation, he will first memorize it himself and later declare the revelation and instruct his companions, who will also memorize it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will immediately ask the scribes to write down the revelation he received and will recheck and reconfirm it himself. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an ummi who could not read and write. Therefore, after receiving each revelation, he will repeat to his companion. They will write down the revelation and will recheck by asking them to read what they had written. If there was any mistake, he would immediately point it out and have it corrected and rechecked. Similarly, he would even recheck and authenticate of the portion of the Quran memorized by different companions. In this way, the complete Quran was written down under the personal supervision of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Subhanallah. But then how was the order and sequence of the Quran placed?
The complete Quran was revealed over a period of 22.5 years, portion by portion, as and when it was required. The Quran was not compiled by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in chronological order of revelation. The order and sequence of the Quran too was divinely inspired and was instructed to the Prophet by Allah through Archangel Jibreel. Whenever a revelation was conveyed to the companions, the Prophet, peace be upon him, will also mention in which surah and after which ayat this new revelation shall fit. Every Ramadan, all the revelations that had been revealed, including the order of the verses, were revised and reconfirmed by Prophet with Archangel Jibreel. During the last Ramadan, before the demise of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the Quran was rechecked and reconfirmed twice.
That means the Quran was rechecked twice before the demise of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yes, whenever Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, received a revelation, he would memorize it himself and later declare the revelation and instruct his companions, who will also memorize it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would immediately ask the scribes to write down the revelation, and he will recheck and reconfirm it himself. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was an ummi who could not read and write. Therefore, after receiving each revelation, he would repeat to his companions. They would write down the revelation and he would recheck by asking them to read what they had written. If there was any mistake, the Prophet, peace be upon him, would immediately point it out and have it corrected and rechecked. Similarly, he would even recheck and authenticate of the portion of the Quran memorized by different companions. In this way, the complete Quran was written down under the personal supervision of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So, it is therefore clearly evident that the Quran was compiled and authenticated by the Prophet himself during his lifetime, both in written form as well as in the memory of several companions.
But then how was the Quran compiled into a form of a book?
The complete Quran, along with the correct sequence of the verses, were present during the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. However, the verses were written on separate pieces, scraps of leather, thin flat stones, leaflets, palm branches, shoulder blades, etc.
Subhanallah.
After the demise of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu ordered that the Quran be copied from the various different materials unto a common material and place. And you know what was that?
No, brother.
This was in the shape of sheets. The sheets were tied with strings so that nothing of the compilation was lost. Many of the companions of the Prophet used to write down the revelation of the Quran on their own whenever they heard from the lips of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. However, what they wrote was not personally verified by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and thus could contain mistakes. All the verses revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, may not have been heard personally by all the companions. This gave a rise to dispute among Muslims regarding the different contexts of the Quran during the time of the third caliph, Usman radiallahu anhu. Usman radiallahu anhu borrowed the original manuscript of the Quran. And you know from whom did he borrow?
I think it was from one of the wives of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Absolutely right. It was Hafsa radiallahu anha, the Prophet's wife. Usman radiallahu anhu ordered four companions who were among the scribes.
Was one of the scribes Zaid bin Thabit radiallahu anhu?
Yes, it was led by Zaid bin Thabit radiallahu anhu to rewrite the script in several perfect copies. These copies were sent by Usman radiallahu anhu to the main centers of Muslims. The collection of the portion of the Quran that people had with them, this might have been incomplete and with mistake. Usman radiallahu anhu only appealed to the people to destroy all these copies so that it does not match the original manuscript of the Quran. In order to preserve the original text of the Quran, to such copies of the copied text of the original Quran authenticated by the Prophet, peace be upon him, are present to this day, one at the museum in Tashkent and other at Topkapi Museum in Istanbul, Turkey.
You mean those original copies still exist?
Yes, it still exists. One at the museum in Tashkent and other at Topkapi Museum in Istanbul, Turkey.
Brother, I wish I could go there.
Inshallah, may Allah make it easy for you. The original manuscript of the Quran does not have signs indicating the vowels in Arabic script. These vowels are known as Tashkil, Zabar, Zair, Pesh in Urdu and as Fatta, Zamma, Kasra in Arabic. The Arabs did not require the diacritical marks and vowel signs for the correct pronunciation since it was their mother tongue. For Muslims of non-Arab origin, however, it was difficult to recite the Quran correctly without the diacritical marks.
Very true.
These marks were introduced into the Quranic script during the time of the fifth Umayyad Caliph. And do you know who was it?
No, brother.
It was Malik Marwan. Between 66 to 86 Hijri or 685 to 705 CE and during the governorship of Al-Hajjaj in Iraq. Some people argue that the present Quran that we have with wall signs and dialectical marks is not the original but that of Usman radiallahu anhu. But they fail to realize that the word Quran means recitation. Therefore, the preservation and recitation of the Quran is important, irrespective of whether the script is different or whether it contains the vowel. If the pronunciation of the Arabic is same, naturally the meaning becomes same too. And brother, Allah has also mentioned in Surah Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 9, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun. We have without doubt sent down the message and will assuredly guard it from corruption.
Jazakallah khair, brother, for helping me know what is the truth. And now I've got it cleared.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.